This is episode 110 of the Reading Cove Book Club's podcast. If you're a book lover who may be interested in joining an online book club, please visit our website at thereadingcove.com to learn more about our group. For January 2020, we're discussing Sorry Not Sorry by Sophie Ranald. So hi, I'm Millenia, back in Florida.
And I'm Roberta, still in Georgia.
And Roberta and I are two members of the Reading Cove Book Club, and today we are here to discuss our group's 230th pick, Sorry Not Sorry, by Sophie Ranald, which was chosen by Cove member Mary way over in Scotland. So, what did we think?
I don't think either one of us liked it a whole lot.
It definitely was not my cuppa, and I have to just admit straight out the gate that I skimmed to be able to finish it just for the Cove. The things I do for this book club.
I know. We all, with our book clubs, yes, we just sometimes have to struggle through stuff that even
Yeah, this one, the reason why it wasn't my cuppa is because Charlotte, the main character, just read to me like an overgrown schoolgirl, and I was bored out of my mind. Mind-numbingly bored. It was just too shallow for me. I had to move on.
Yeah. Well, I mean, well, at first I thought, well, maybe this is just not my demographic because, you know, I'm older.
Yeah.
Charlotte and her friends. Well, most of us are. Mm-hmm. But anyway, but yeah, I mean, this was sort of a little bit, I think someone in our Cove group mentioned it kind of reminded them of Bridget Jones. Because this woman just fretted all too much. Yes, I mean, it's tough where your friends around you are getting married and settling down, and you're still single, and you haven't really had any good romances, even your probably most recent one, that it didn't work out well. Mm-hmm. But, you know, at the same time, I don't think that it's always going to help to go on the hunt, so to speak, like she did. You know, you just don't need to settle for someone just to be married or, you know, go looking for love in all the wrong places, as they would say. So, I mean, I just didn't feel a whole lot of empathy for Charlotte most of the time. That, I mean, at least she had some good friends, you know. Not everybody could say that, too. She had good friends.
She had good friends, but I couldn't find the interest. And there are so many other things to pay attention to.
Right.
That this just wasn't for me.
No.
At all. The group overall rated it a C. I think there were a couple people who gave it a B or B minus, but for the most part, everybody was C, D.
Yeah. It was one of our favorite books, that's for sure.
Yeah, it averaged out to a C, an okay story. And we're kind of winding down the discussion in the group. So, I mean, it was a pretty good discussion.
Yes, it was.
And like the twist at the end, most people were surprised that Sloan had done the Sorry Not Sorry podcast.
Yeah, well, I was kind of surprised. But when you look back, it made sense. But it did kind of surprise me. That was probably the only thing that I even gave it a C for, is because I thought, oh, I wasn't expecting that. So I think that's the one thing the author did want you to think, oh, wow. You know, how ironic is that?
Yeah.
And then it was like that Sloan is giving Charlotte the big brush off when she really doesn't know who she is or why she's even approaching her.
Right. And then a lot of comments, people, you know, were saying that the ending saved it for them.
Yes. I think that's true. You know, otherwise it would have been just another story of a woman lured into making bad decisions by this charming, handsome man and, you know, didn't really look into things more closely, and that even went back after she had said she wasn't going to see him anymore, too. She got lulled back because, you know, so that's usually the usual line you hear both in stories and real life is that, oh, he said he was leaving his wife, or he said he was getting a divorce. And usually that doesn't work out well for anybody.
Right. Usually it doesn't. And even if they do leave the wife or the girlfriend for you, if they'll do it with you, they'll do it to you.
I know. And then his flimsy excuse kids were like, she'd say, well, why did you do this? And I was like, well, you know, don't I deserve a little fun? This has all been so stressful. And you want to think, you know, if I was a violent person, I would have slapped him about it. I don't say women might not do it, but that's just a guy thing. It's like, well, if times are tough and things are rough, then I deserve a little fun. Can justify your bad behavior, you know, by that. So, but yeah, it seems like, it, you know, even though it was Charlotte, but it just seems like the place he was in, if it hadn't been her, it would have been somebody else.
Exactly.
But she just seemed, she was unfortunately in a vulnerable spot. And here was this man that was handsome and charming and all of a sudden paying all this attention to her after she, you know, felt really bad. Mm-hmm. And, you know, then, like I say, he wooed her back again at that time when she was on that fancy weekend. They called it in England a hen party, like a fancy bachelorette party. Mm-hmm. The people had been nicer to her, she probably wouldn't have gone back off with him. Right. But instead, she got treated so poorly by the others who'd been brainwashed by the evil Bianca. I mean, the only good thing Bianca ever did was, you know, tell her the truth of the matter, but in an ugly way. But still, she told her, you know, don't fool yourself. This isn't what's happening at all. So in her evilness, she finally kind of set her straight.
Right. Yeah. And did you find any of it funny?
Not really, because it said it's supposed to be laugh out loud, and I didn't find anything funny.
I was like, there is nothing funny. It's just rambling nonsense to me. I mean, maybe yeah. I am also out of the demographic.
It just wasn't funny, you know. Stephanie Plum is funny, but this was not funny.
Yeah, I just felt like I was wasting my time, unfortunately.
Yeah, well, and even her roommate, you know, after the Henry and Maddie left, mm-hmm. that Adam, and he was just weird to get go.
Yeah, the new roommates were so weird.
They were weird. I mean, but at least, you know, poor Tansy was trying to make a better life and help out her, you know, mother, but then she kind of messed things up. But at least she was befriending Charlotte. But Adam, you find out that, you know, he could have gotten, just was by luck that Charlotte found out he was the one responsible for all this stuff, and he didn't worry about how it affected her. He was like these people back in the 60s that thought, well, they could do these horrible, violent things to try to right this in the system. And he was just a wackadoodle. And then when he tried to put the moves on her when she was drunk, mm-hmm. that made him even more despicable.
Yeah.
He was just awful. And it didn't matter that he was nice, sweet Henry's, was it cousin? Mm-hmm. But he, you know, you think, well, this guy's just got some really serious issues going on.
Yeah, and to think that I thought it was interesting that Charlotte left her previous relationship simply because it just wasn't, you know, he was boring her or something.
Yeah.
Just wasn't doing anything for her. She didn't feel, you know, the spark with him.
Yeah, well, you know, you can understand that partway because you don't want to spend the rest of your life with somebody that's going to be, you know, you're going to be bored stiff. But at the same time, it's better to be with somebody that's more settled and more, quote, normal than, you know, to be off with some wild and crazy guy that you don't know that you could trust, like
it
you said.
It just felt like when I was reading how she was feeling in the previous relationship and why it ended, mm-hmm. I just thought, okay, yeah, she's looking for trouble and she's going to find it. Because, you know, when she yeah. was in a stable, yeah. secure relationship with a guy that was apparently a good guy,
yeah,
not a bad guy, that just wasn't doing anything for her. So now she's off almost screwing the guy who came to fix something in the apartment, you know, that she just met.
Well, maybe she was attracted, but you think she's too old for that, you know, because a lot of girls when they're younger get attracted to the bad boys, you know. The
yeah,
bad boys,
and she
you know.
Seemed that way. And then she ends up having an affair with a married man.
I know.
And whining about that.
That's just always a bad idea, you know, unless someone's completely divorced and completely cut off from their ex-wife, then that's just a bad plan.
Yeah, but unfortunately, a lot of women feel empowered by that. By the fact that they can turn another woman's man's head. That's how they get their self-esteem boosted. So,
yeah. It usually doesn't end well, like I said.
Exactly.
You know? Like you said, sometimes it does, but then, as you said earlier, that if he's going to fool around on one person, he'll probably fool around
on you. He will definitely fool around on you. for sure.
Just, you know, it's just the way he is. It's the way he's wired, and mm-hmm. you know, he's not going to change.
Exactly.
So the
catch is short lived, because as soon as you become the stale bread, he's going to go looking for fresh bread.
Right. That's a good analogy. Yes, that's true. But I think probably the best character in the whole thing was Henry, because he was just trying to do the right thing and mm-hmm. be supportive. But Maddie, I know she apologized later, but she got herself all wrapped up and controlled by Bianca, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I know part of it's because Bianca lied to her about some of these things, told lies about mm-hmm. Charlotte, but at the same time, you know, you shouldn't get wooed over by this other person, toss over your best friend that's been supportive to you forever.
Yeah.
But, you know, I think she just got lured into this stuff and talked into doing all this fancy stuff and everything.
Yeah.
But Bianca was just a hot mess too, because, you know, they tell you that she really didn't have many friends because she drove them off with her controlling, manipulative things and was just kind of, you know, mean to people. Nobody wants that. You know, you may think at first, well, she's helping you and she's got all this good taste and so forth, but stuff like that, after a while, people finally figure out how negative she is, and they just kind of run. Can't blame them.
Exactly.
It was just one of those things where, it, like you said, just wasn't our cup of tea, but mm-hmm. maybe other people, you know, the woman's written some other books, some people have, you know, bought them or read them, so mm-hmm. everybody has, I guess, a certain amount of fan base, but
exactly. There's something for everybody.
Our thing, you know, I just get irked with some of these people, no matter if they're young or not, that just really make really bad choices.
Exactly. You know, we've mentioned Bridget Jones,
uh-huh.
and I did not like Bridget Jones's Diary, the book. I think it was a Cove pick back in the day.
Well, yeah, I think so. Yeah.
And I did not like it, but I love the movie.
That was one of the few cases where the movie was actually much better than the book.
To me, yeah. It was definitely to me.
It seemed too whiny and
yeah, just like this, rambling, and it's like, who cares about this girl? I just didn't care about it.
The movie just sort of, you know, especially with Renee Zellweger, just sort of brought it to life and mm-hmm. made it actually funny.
Exactly. Her performance just really, really brought it to life. And then I think that was the better format for that story, at least for me. Right. I don't like reading about that type of stuff.
No.
It's just boring.
It is. Like I said, I read the book because it was all the hype and everything then anyway. But like I said, there's a very few cases where you actually think, wow, you know, they really did something good with this.
Exactly. Can you think of another one you felt that way about? The movie was
better
than the book?
The English Patient.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. With the visual things, you could follow them in that. But the book, it was hard to follow for mm-hmm. me, at least.
Yeah.
But the visual things in the movie, I think, oh, yeah, you know, this makes sense now. Because sometimes these more literary books, they may, you know, be wonderful literary things, but they're just so worried about the style and everything, more so
right.
than story. And all the performances and the really neat visuals really made for a much better experience, in my humble opinion.
Another one that I enjoyed the movie more than the book was Legends of the Fall.
Oh,
you remember
yeah.
that?
Oh, yes. Yes.
The movie is much better than the book to me.
Yeah, I totally agree.
And I also felt that way about The Fault in Our Stars.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I liked the movie. I wasn't that crazy about the book because it was, you know, YA, and there was a lot of like teeny bopper stuff in there that I just was bored with.
Yeah.
So, but the movie was super engaging. The performances and yeah.
Even if it's a good story, but if you have the right cast and the right director,
mm-hmm.
it just really brings it alive. And it's,
exactly.
like you said, it's a lot more engaging than
yes,
just reading the prose part. But yeah, I like that movie a lot better than the book, too.
Yeah. So any other thoughts or anything you can remember from everybody's comments?
Well, I'm just saying, I think a lot of them had similar feelings that they just, you know, had a hard time empathizing with most of the characters, and that they could spot that, you know, Miles was a weasel from the get-go.
Yeah.
But like, as you said, most of the members were surprised at the twist at the end. They really were. So
yeah, Monica, I think, is the only one who said she kind of figured that out.
Well, and some people see things better. You know, I've read so many mysteries over time, and sometimes I can know what's going to happen, but that sometimes get to the end and think, wow, that was some writing, because I never thought of that, you know.
Exactly.
If you start go back and look back at stuff, you think, well, they did kind of, you know, work up to that, but at the same time, they were really good, because you just didn't see that coming. It just really caught you, you know, surprise. You know, it's just a true twist, and then afterwards you're thinking, this was a really good book. You know, mm-hmm. They didn't do this twist without making it seem like it was all contrived or hokey or whatever. So,
yeah.
To me, that's a sign of a good author, that they can surprise you with things that you weren't expecting at all.
And it be plausible.
And be plausible. Not like, yeah, right.
we had that recently with the Harlan Coben book, Runaway.
Yes.
Did not see that ending coming.
I did not see that ending happen either. So, yeah. He's a good writer, and I've enjoyed just about all of his books, both the standalones and the series, which a lot of people don't care for.
Alrighty then, so that's our discussion of Sorry Not Sorry by Sophie Ranald. Want to thank our listeners for tuning in, and please leave us your comments below. Let us know what you thought of this book, and stay tuned for our next episode. We'll be discussing Stealing Love by H. Schreder? I'm not sure. But we're looking forward to it. See you next time. Bye.
Bye.